Greetings, YouTube, and welcome to the Little Corner and to another Waking the Dragon segment. If you're watching this, then it is probably New Year's Eve, and so I figure what better way to wrap up the year than by giving you guys the teching and side teching video that I've been talking about for a while. I've got a whole bunch of cards here set aside, along with a list of their pros and cons and whatnot. Yeah, I kind of went the mile and planned this out a little bit ahead of time. And yeah, I'm just going to be discussing some cards that are very good for your main deck and your side deck while listing both their good points and their bad points, and ultimately just letting you guys decide which combination suits you best. Now, we are wrapping up the year 2011, and within a few weeks, a new booster set will be coming out that will have a bit of impact on the metagame. We will be having the release of Ninjas, and then Insectors are also going to be coming out with an Order of Chaos, and I will not lie, you guys, Insectors are a very tough deck to beat. They are getting a ton of hype, and for good reason. That deck can go +4 out of nowhere with only just a few cards. It's insane trying to beat them, and you definitely do need to take great care in trying to handle that deck. That being said, let's get on with teching and side decking. Okay, so leading this off, we're going to be going over Prime Material Dragon, a card that was once considered a backbone of the deck, but has now been largely ignored. He is, however, getting attention again due to the fact that next month, more and more decks are going to be playing increased amounts of Mantra Destruction, both because of Insectors and just as a reflection of what the game has become. Thunder King Ra is being played in so many decks, therefore people are starting the main deck Smashing Ground. Mirror Force, just more destruction effects that get rid of Thunder King or that other lockdown monster. And because more and more destruction effects are being played, Prime Material Dragon is starting to see as action again as a means of getting around those cards. By having Prime Material Dragon out, say, against Insectors, they're forced to go after your back row, because unlike Stardust Dragon, where they try and kill it, Stardust negates, and they just proceed to do the rest of their +4 combo by continuously doing Hornet stuff, Prime Material Dragon will keep your monsters safe, and Insector players don't really have a means of getting over something with high attack, other than Exceed Summoning, so they'll be forced to make Leviathan Dragon, or later on Acid Golem, so on and so on, and chances are you'll probably have a Darkness Metal Dragon on the field, so even if they do kill this guy with Leviathan Dragon, Darkness Metal can just bring it back and you can punch over their crap. Now, unfortunately, Prime Material Dragon still has the downsides that made us not use him for a long while, and that is, he's a big monster that you more often than not want to dump with Future Fusion. He's never really been a fun card to draw, and his stats require him to give up a monster just for it to hit the field outside of Darkness Metal. Furthermore, his attack at 2400 just does not really do that good anymore. Most decks have access to some kind of 2500 attack beatstick, such as Leviathan Dragon, Utopia, or Stardust, meaning battle-wise, Prime Material Dragon is easily defeated. So, again, he's a card that's going to take some great care to play, but as a main or side deck card, he is going to be rather useful next month. Furthermore, there is that rare chance you'll go up against some guy who plays Burn. Next up, Yamada Dragon. This is a card I have always liked, and he's always been a good card. He just hasn't really seen much play due to the circumstances. Last format, it was because there was so much back row. Start of this format was actually a pretty good time to play Yamada Dragon. I just never played him because I wanted to make space for Galaxy Eyes and Vlad and so on, but basically, when this guy gets a battle damage in, you plus a million. Unfortunately, he is a big monster, level 7, so you do gotta sack off two guys or a totem. And he's a spirit, so he does come back to the hand in the end phase. And there's a good chance that you will draw him when you can't, and he'll just sit there dead. However, with the release of Divine Dragon Apocalypse next month, you now have some plays that you can make with this guy. If it's early game and he's dead, you can just discard him to get back into more useful monsters such as Smash Dragon. And if it's late game and your Mono Dragon's still in the graveyard, you can pitch that Gold Sarcophagus you don't need anymore and put your Mono Dragon back in your hand because you got a Totem Dragon in the graveyard now, and you're free to do that stuff. all in all, he's always just been a very good card. He just has not had much opportunity to see play. But with an easier means of getting into your hand and dropping him, along with an easier means of getting rid of back row, with the 3 MST, Heavy Storm, Dust Tornado, so on and so on, Yamato Dragon is looking to be a very nice card to run again. Spirit Well Disaster would definitely be one of my picks to run after next month. Next up, Golem Dragon. Now this might be an odd pick. I got this idea actually from a post that Awaken Zero made on the forums, in that he was running this for a couple of reasons. And in playing around with this, I can actually see how this card is rather useful. First up, his stats of 200 attack means that he is searchable through Mash Dragon, and cards that are searchable through Mash Dragon are always worth looking at. Secondly, he's got that 2,000 defense, meaning when you summon it, he's going to sit there, and chances are, if it's early game, your opponent's not going to have a means of getting around it, because most decks only run 1,900 attack as their normal summonable monster beat stick. So Thunder King, Tengu, yeah, all those cards can't get over this. He also has the nifty ability of being able to redirect attacks towards himself. So if you've got a Quackamew Drago on the field and your opponent, even though they can't like special summon lighter dark monsters, is still able to summon a big monster, that big monster is going to have to kill this guy first before they can kill Drago, allowing you to make some kind of follow-up play that allows you to keep Drago on the field or get rid of their big monster. Furthermore, his 200 attack also means that he is revivable with Debris Dragon, and while this isn't relevant now, come June when the Kaikuchi Dragon comes out, it will be, because now Debris Dragon can summon this guy, you can overlay, drop a 2100 attacker that can battle twice in the same turn by detaching material. So you can in fact summon Kaikuchi Dragon while your Quackamew Drago's on the field, swing, detach, swing again, and then swing for 19. Pretty nice. On the downside though, this is a guy you kind of don't always want to have in your hand, you just want to search it up through Mash Dragon, and this is just a beef on my part, but I really do wish he had an ability that prevented dragons from being destroyed by card effects. That would have just made this so much better if you could summon it through Mash Dragon and he sits there and it's like no Smashing Ground or no Dark Hole, you know, none of that crap. But still, he's a rather nice card, and depending on deck space, you can run it or not. Next, I want to mention is going up to 2 Exploder Dragon in your main. Exploder Dragon is a nice card. However, there are times where you kind of want to draw it faster. Running 2 Exploder Dragon solves that problem. You are facing down an Archlord Christia, and you don't really know what you can do. Well, look at that. You drew another Exploder Dragon. Awesome. Now you can summon it and crash into Christia. Crash into Master Perion. Crash into that monster you know they're trying to keep safe and honest. What have you. Now, on the downside, though, setting your Exploder Dragon is still a rather slow play in a format where people are just aggro, destruction, removal, and so on. So you might not be able to get his effect off that often, but because you're running 2 Exploder Dragons, it will be easier for you to do what you need to do with the guy. And last monster I want to talk about, and you saw him in my extra deck last video, is Blackwing Dragon. This 2100 attacker basically stops burn. Now, admittedly, he's very specialized in what he does. He's only good for stopping burn decks and being food for deck devastation virus if you're like me and like to run that card now and then. And if you're in need of extra deck space and need to fit in another monster, then this is probably not going to be staying in your deck. But for what he does, he's very good. And that's it for the monsters. Coming up next, spells. Okay, so the first spell I want to talk about, would be a Wingbeat Giant Dragon. Now, this card has seen some play on and off in the deck. I used it a couple formats ago back when Heavy Storm was banned, and now that we do have Heavy Storm back, this has pretty much become non-existent. What it does is you return a level 5 or higher Dragon-type monster to the hand in order to completely nuke all back row. Now, obviously, the best card to use for this is Vice Dragon, as you can just special summon it because your opponent has a monster, bounce it back to the hand to blow up everything, special summon it again, and proceed to remove it for Darkness Metal, or even synchro it off to make Stardust, what have you. Unfortunately, the monster has to be face up on the field for this resolve, so if they book or compulse your Vice Dragon, then a Wing Beat will resolve without effect. Furthermore, this card is really only usable if you have a lot of level 5 or higher monsters. If you're running just your 3 Darkness Metals, then you're probably not going to be able to get this thing off that often. There are some other ways to make it work, though. You could have Delta Flyer on the field and a level 4, bump the level 4 to 5, put it back to the hand, blow stuff up, or you could summon Totem Dragon from the graveyard with Darkness Metal, bounce him to blow everything up with Wing Beat, and then sack the Totem off for Darkness Metal, and then special summon what you need again, like Quackmere Drago or Prime Material. So those are other ways to get this card to work. Will it see continued play? I don't think so, at least not at this point in the game. Decks are somewhat light on back row, and most back row consists of either the Solemn Brigade or Chainables. Next up, Creature Spot. This is actually a very good card for the decks that can support it, i.e. Disaster in the Pocket. Yeah, that's what I like to call Pokey Draco-based disasters. Basically, you'd summon a floater or a recruiter such as Pokey Draco, Fast Dragon, or Dread Dragon, or some weak guy like Totem Dragon, or even Quackmere Drago, and then you just creature swap that guy over to their side of the field, take their big monster, and just proceed to troll them as you punch over Fast Dragon and get a monster out. I've actually done this before with the Pokey Draco type disaster. I summon Fast Dragon, I creature swap it with Scrap Dragon, and I punch over Fast Dragon with Scrap Dragon, and I pulled out, I think it was a Dread Dragon, and then I had options from there on. The Dread Dragon would die, I get to search, the Dread Dragon stays on there, hey, I can go Triton Dragon in the next turn. But, yeah, basically, those type of decks are really good with this card, but it's not that good outside of them. You can't really just throw this into Standard Disaster and expect to get the same kind of benefits, as it just does not run that many kind of floater monsters. But it is good for what it does. Next up, Forbidden Chalice. This card's actually been pretty neat. It acts as both a 400 attack boost to a random monster and an effect miller. It's a quick play, and it's an attack modifier, so it is usable in the damage step. It is chainable, so if you've got Darkness Metal Dragon on the field, and they go Heavy Storm, you can chain this and pump up Darkness Metal by 400, meaning Colossal Fighter can't crash into it. Blue Eyes by Dragon, yeah, I know, or just generic 3,000 beater, they can't run over Darkness Metal Dragon either. It negates the monster effect, so you can chain this in response to something that really bad, such as Black Rose Dragon. Black Rose does become 2,800 attack for the turn, I admit that, but on the other hand, you don't lose everything to the Black Rose. The only real downside to this is it's a neg 1, and some people just don't really like playing cards that are inherent neg 1 unless you can find some way to follow it up. On a similar note, there is Forbidden Lands. Like Chalice, it's a neg 1, and like Chalice, it also modifies your stats. In this case, though, it's a monster loses 800 attack at the bonus of being unaffected by all spell and trap cards for that turn. The uses this has had in the deck are fairly obvious. You can use it to keep your Quackmere Drago safe from Dimensional Prison, Dark Hole, Bottomless. You can use it to keep Darkness Metal Dragon safe from those very same cards. Last format, if you had Royal Oppression on the field, you could activate Darkness Metal's effect. They chain Oppression. You play this, your Darkness Metal becomes immune to Oppression, and they lose 800 life points for the turn. All in all, this is actually not that bad of a card, but again, it's a neg 1, and there's probably just things that you could run in its place. I would slightly consider it, though, again, for the main or the side. It's going to be rather useful with the increased amounts of monster destruction that will be lying around in case you don't have Prime Material Dragon. Gold Sarcophagus. This is a card I also started running again. Now, we all know the negs of this guy. It's a minus 1 for 2 turns, and in this game you don't really want to be putting yourself down in advantage for very long. But on the other hand, it is a guaranteed search. It will get you what you need as opposed to chancing it with Pot of Duality, and it does not shut you off for special summoning for the turn. And again, in this aggressive sack fest of a format, you want to be getting the aggro on as fast as you can. And Gold Sarcophagus lets you search stuff out while being able to do those extremely powerful plays. And yeah, that's pretty much all it is about this guy. Unfortunately, it's also a dead draw in the late game, but we've learned to deal with that in the few years that we've been running this card in our main. Next up, Smashing Ground. This has always been a really fun card to have. It's a 1-for-1 that kills Thunder King, Reaper, Christia, and also baits out the effect of Alvazar Lagia. They have to negate this or they lose their guy, and then you can just summon Darkness Metal and punch over the stupid thing. Unfortunately, that's really all it can do. It's a 1-for-1 removal at best. So, yeah, you run it, you kill stuff. And if you're not meaning it, I would definitely consider siding it. And the last spell card is Dragon's Mirror. This awesome card removes 5 dragons from your graveyard, so you can special summon a 5,000 attack beatstick that is easily killed by Mirror Force. I'm just kidding. This card's bad. It's really bad. I just figured I'd play a joke on you all. Okay, that's it for spells. Coming up next, Trap. Okay, the first trap I'm going to mention is an old goodie, and that is Burst Breath. This card has been really useful for us in the past, and I could see it being useful again in the future. What it does is you just sack off a dragon and then proceed to nuke your opponent's monsters, and even your own, depending on what kind of monster you attributed. And cards such as Exploder Dragon can kill a lot of stuff when you think about it. So many decks these days run monsters with high attack and low defense. Thunder King Ryle, the Agent of Creation Venus, Reborn Tengu, I mean, so many of these cards have less than 1,000 defense. So Exploder Dragon, he can wipe out all of those things. Good example, your opponent summons the Agent of Creation Venus. They pay life points. They bring up 4 Shine Balls. You chain Burst Breath, sacking off Exploder Dragon, and you completely wipe out their field. Whereas before, the Exploder Dragon would have just killed the Venus, and the Gantetsu would have just stayed on there. Bigger monsters, such as Darkness Metal Dragon or Quackmere Drago, if you swing at their guy and they try and deprison it, you can Burst Breath them off the field and proceed to wipe out more stuff. It's also a good means of getting rid of your Quackmere Drago. Another example, you've got Quackmere Drago on the field after you performed a Future Fusion dump the turn prior. Your 5-headed dragon is coming up next turn. Your opponent has no back row, so you know he's not going to be they can't get rid of it. But they've got some monsters on board. Sack off the dragon with Burst Breath, kill those tokens they have, and the next turn you drop 5-headed dragon. It's a pretty dick move, and it's hilarious. That being said, the problem with Burst Breath is, unless you chain it in response to some kind of effect, it's going to be a -1 most of the time. It's a 2-for-1 exchange, and more often than not, you're going to be waiting until your opponent puts 2 monsters on the board, or they try and MST this, so that you can somewhat balance out the exchange in cards. The next card I want to talk about is Compulsory Evacuation Device, and this has actually been a rather nice card for me as of late. What it can do is quite a lot of things. Notably, you can use it to save your own monster from card effects, such as Dark Hole, Dimensional Prison, Smashing Ground, Creature Swap, well, not so much as Creature Swap, but if you, say, have a Quackmere Drago that you're trying to summon, you summon it, and they go Bottomless Trap Hole. You can chain Compulsory Evacuation Device to put the monster back to your hand so you can use it again. You can use it to bounce away any Xyz monster that exists in the game, and you can use it to bounce away just about every Synchro Infusion monster that's not called Thought Ruler Archfiend. So it's an instant out to those cards, 1-for-1 exchange. You can use it also to disrupt your opponent's plays, such as they go Rescue Rabbit, summon 2 Cabazulas. You compulse the 1 Cabazulas back to the hand, the other one stays on the field, and it dies at the end phase, because they don't have another one to perform the Xyz summon with. It can also be used to basically get rid of your opponent's setup plays. So if they summon a tuner that they're trying to perform a Synchro summon with, you compulse the tuner or the non-tuner monster, and now their guy's left out in attack. If it was the Debris Dragon, it gets rid of tokens, and yeah, it does a lot of things, and furthermore, it's chainable like Book of Moon. This card is absolutely amazing, and it does, though, have some downsides. It's an inherent -1, unless you chain it to, say, a spell or trap effect, or you bounce off an Xyz or Synchro monster, and it really only solves a problem monster for a single turn. Your opponent can just simply put back down the monster you bounced with this card's effect. But I do believe the many positives of this card, such as bouncing away that Spear Reaper they've been sitting 9 behind, and then summoning, say, Exploder, Banish, Darkness Metal, Primordial Dragon, Swing for Game, I believe the positives outweigh the negatives with this card, and it's just a really nice thing to have in the main. Next tech, and this is somewhat limited to what decks can be used for, but Deck Devastation Virus. Now, you guys know how much I love this card. It's abusing the hell out of this is the sole reason why I created Pandemic Dragon. And a lot of the decks that are played these days have monsters with low attack. Tour Guide from the Underworld, Sangan, Dandelion, Insectors, some of the ninjas. I mean, so many of these setup cards these days fall under 1500 attack, and Deck Devastation Virus completely wrecks those things. And you get to see your opponent's hand and look in their next three draws. Overall, it's a very nice thing. Unfortunately, there are very few targets for it. You've got Darkness Metal, Dark End Dragon, and Red Dragon Archfiend in your extra deck, as far as pure dragons go. To really take the full advantage of this here, you have to basically add more high attack dark monsters into your deck and extra deck. Hello, Pandemic Dragon. But still, for what Deck Devastation does, it's actually pretty powerful. It will definitely put in some work. Now, the next card I want to talk about is Fiendish Chain, and this card is actually looking very, very, very nice next month. What it does is it targets one face-up effect monster and negates its effect. Furthermore, that thing cannot attack. If it is destroyed, destroy this card. It stays on the field, though, if that monster gets tributed or synchroed or exceeds off. But otherwise, it's a very nice card to have. It stops all these searchers that come out. The Agent of Creation, the Agent of Mystery Earth, Tour Guide from the Underworld, so on and so on. And more importantly, it gives us a means of stopping those annoying Insector cards. They summon Insector, Dragonfly? Yeah, Dragonfly. I keep wanting to call it Damsel, but that's its other name. But yeah, they summon Insector Dragonfly, your Fiendish Chain it, it just sits there, and now you're Red Eyes Wyvern can just punch over the thing. Fiendish Chain is extremely helpful, especially for us, because we can't main deck Effect Mailer in builds that run Totem Dragon. If you're running a totemless build, such as Anti-Meta Disaster, then Effect Mailer is a good choice to run as well. I, in fact, even consider Fiendish Chain and Effect Mailer in that build, or Effect Mailer in your side deck. In fact, Effect Mailer in your side deck for Standard Disaster is also something I recommend, but needless to say, Fiendish Chain in 3 is something I would try and get for Standard Disaster, and even possibly the Egg. The Egg is actually looking very nice next month as well, because it's got access to a 3,000 beater, search, speed, and 3 to 4 Solemn Judgments. But anyway, needless to say, yeah, I like this card a lot, and I'm really happy I got 3 while it was still relatively cheap. This thing's probably going to be going up in price again. So, and it will always be very good, as this game is always effect monster driven. However, things to note, if you Fiendish Chain something like Stardust or Thunder King or Doomcal, they still get to use their effects and they'll resolve because they activate in graveyard. Before, I believe it was like last year, if you Fiendish Chain a Stardust Dragon, it couldn't activate its effect at all and it could be killed by Mirror Force. However, things have changed and now it's being ruled that if you Fiendish Chain a Stardust Dragon, its effect can still be used to protect the stuff from being destroyed by card effects. Remember this one, because if your Stardust Dragon gets Fiendish Chain, and then they try to Heavy Storm or Mirror Force, you can activate Stardust Dragon's effect and negate the destruction effect of the card they're playing, and Fiendish Chain can't do jack shit about that. So, all in all, very nice card. I try to get your playset now, while it's only $14 a piece. Next card I want to talk about is Liberty at Last. This is somewhat like Impulse Ray Vacuum Device, and its actual effect is when a monster you control is destroyed by battle and sent to the graveyard, you select two face-up monsters and return them to the deck. The original printing of this card from Tag Force 5 says to the hand, but it's been eroded, and it's ruled now that they go to the deck. Now, what this does is, much like Impulse, it eliminates problem monster cards such as Synchros, Fusions, Xyz, and just gets them off the field completely. It also gets annoying monsters such as Reborn Tengu back in the deck, where his effect won't activate. However, there has to be two face-up monsters on the field. It's not select up to two face-ups. So if they have only one monster, and you have one monster on your side of the field that are face-up, and you spring this, then your monster is gone as well. But it is rather useful for those situations where they have Venus plus Gentetsu, or they have like two monsters on the board, and they kill a Mass Dragon or a Dread Dragon, you flip this up, bounce those to the deck, in addition to getting a search or special summon. Unfortunately, it is very slow, and unlike Chain, Disappearance, Deck Debbie, and all those cards I mentioned before, You can't use it in response to a blind MST, so it is vulnerable to those type of cards. Magic Drain. This is a neat little one or two if you can run your deck. Basically, it acts as a 1-for-1 or even a +1. Your opponent activates their power spell, such as Heavy Storm. You chain this, they're forced to pitch a spell card to let the storm go through, or they'll just not need to pitch a spell, and therefore Magic Drain will just stop the storm. So either way, you're going to be getting some kind of bonus off of this card. On the downside though, many decks run like 18 plus spells, so unless they really, really want that storm to go through, they're more or less going to pitch that spell card, and Magic Drain will just not negate stuff. Somewhat related is Seven Tools of the Bandit. Now, this card I actually think might be rather useful because decks are starting to play more back row again. You're seeing Solemn Brigade, D-Prison, Bottomless, Force TT, Dust Shoot, so on and so on. All those cards are in most, if not all, decks, or at least in their side. And 7 tools for 1,000 life points stops all of them. However, there are those decks where this card is completely dead against, such as Agents, because all they ever run is just Trap Dust Shoot. But for what it does, it puts in work. Spiritual Wind Dart Miyabi. This is a fun card that I have not actually been using as of late because I just don't have that many targets for it anymore. You sack a wind monster to spin something on the field back to your opponent's deck. Most of the time it's a neg one unless you use it in response to something like Deep Prison. And that's pretty much all it is. I mean, some builds just can't use this at all, like standard. But other variants such as Category 5 can abuse the hell out of this by chaining this to sack off Dragoonly Phalanx, Stardust Dragon if it tries to get prisoned, and so on. And then you just spin that monster back in the deck. And once again, it trolls Reborn Tengu like you would not believe because his effect does not resolve while he's spinned to the deck. And the last card I want to mention is Starlight Road. You run lots of back row. This card keeps you safe from Heavy Storm, also keeps your monster safe from Mirror Force and Dark Hole. And so many people will walk into this card and net you that massive +1 of a Stardust Dragon along with a negate. On the other hand, smart players won't run into this. If you set a lot of back row, they know you've got the road down, or they'll probably try and pick off some other cards so that when you do have the road, it's not going to be useful. Or they'll set themselves up so that the road does not completely bother them. Furthermore, Solemn Warning kills Starlight Road because it has an effect that special summons. You have to remember that one. Especially if you have a Solemn Warning down and you Heavy Storm and your opponent tries to flip Starlight Road up. You can Solemn Warning it and it's a perfectly legal play. Of course, if you're doing this on Dueling Network, chances are you're going to be playing against someone who does not know that, and so they'll bitch like crazy and eventually rage quit on you. And that's it for the main deck. The next cards I want to talk about are all things you can run in your side deck. Okay, so before I go on, I'm just going to get the obvious ones out of the way. Most side decks are probably running some combination of these cards. Then you've got your Cyber Dragons, your Vec Veilers, your Thunder King Ryos, and Maxi. You probably have some combination of that in your side, because these are all very powerful cards. That all being said, now let's get on to the more interesting stuff. The first card I want to talk about is Shadow Imprisoning Mirror. This has been getting a lot of attention due to the fact that it is helpful both against Dark Worlds and the upcoming Insectors. What it does is it negates the effects of dark monsters that activate on the field or in the graveyard. Now, this stops Insectors' ability to equip cards themselves, it stops Dark Worlds' abilities that activate in the graveyard because they were discarded, and it does stop Darkness Metal Dragon's ability to special summon stuff from the graveyard. So you gotta take care in playing this card, right? Basically, it's more useful for when you're siding in against the decks that suffer far more from it than you do. You'd want to have an ideal setup of Shadow Imprisoning Mirror and then Prime Material Dragon or Stardust Dragon so that they can't summon do their dark monster effects that would wreck your day. And Stardust Dragon can keep your Shadow Imprisoning Mirrors from the 3 MST that most Insector decks are probably going to side in along with Dark Worlds. So most decks run 3 MST after Game 1, so you got to be prepared for that. And it is a card that has many good things and many bad things for you, but As it stands, it is one of the Zaster Dragon's best means of combating the Insector threat for games 2 and 3. For games 2 and 3, you're probably going to want to go 2 Mirror, 3 Chain, 2 Veiler, and Primordial Dragon. That's how I would try and handle those guys. And for what it does, yeah, just be very careful in playing. It's somewhat like Royal Oppression, but it's also not at the same time. Then, of course, we got Chain Disappearance. This card wrecks so much crap. And again, it's another out to Insectors, because their main card, Insector Dragonfly, is 1,000 attack or less. So if you get Chain Disappearance off and remove all three, it does really hamper the deck. Up next, Black Horn of Heaven. I am really upset I only have one, but basically it acts as another Solemn Judgment. It negates Inherence, Cyber Dragon, Xyz, Synchros. Yeah, it's good at what it does. This card, you know how much I love this and how much of a headache it is for other people. Konami still has not made an official errata, although if you do run this at a regionals or YCS, they are going to go with the OCG rulings. And that said, it's always a very powerful card to have against decks such as Plant Synchro or even Dino Rabbit, because you flip this up in response to a Rescue Rabbit summon. It would be after the Rabbit summon activates. So they banish Rabbit and they bring up their two dinosaurs. You flip Rabbit with the Warlords up. They can't summon Logia because he's a dragon type monster and they have dinosaurs on the field. And so they're completely fucked in that regard. Because again, their monsters will die, they don't get their Xyz monster, and you kind of mucks them up. Many decks also run Thunder King Ryle. But what other Thunder type monsters do those decks run? They summon Thunder King Ryle, okay, you flip up the Bribery of the Warlords, now they can't summon anything other than Thunder-type monsters, and chances are, Ryle is their only Thunder-type monster, so he's just going to sit there by himself, without backup, while you are free to use your many dragons and eventually kill the stupid bugger. And much like with Quackamy Drago, you have to meet the conditions of this card first before you can do anything. You can't send monsters off to the graveyard for a synchro summon and then summon something of a different type. You can't overlay your monsters and you can't overlay your two Tengus and summon a Utopia because they're completely different monster types. Kaiko. Yeah, this card's been pretty nice. I just haven't had an opportunity to run in my side very often, but he is what he does. He prevents decks such as Plants and Chaos from summoning their big monsters. You regulate their graveyard, remove the threats, and he's actually not that bad of an idea against Insectors. You attack with him, and you remove those Hornets that are in the graveyard, and that just kind of slows them up. Dust Tornado, always a nice card. Remove back row, helps clear the way for your dragons. Last but not least, Debunk. Shuts off hand traps, graveyard search effects, what have you. It's a pretty nice card overall. Unfortunately, this thing just refuses to be drawn when I want it. Or I draw it after the stuff that happens on in the graveyard completely wrecks my stuff. And that concludes my teching and side decking segment. I hope this was really helpful to you guys. As for what actual side deck I would run, I am not quite sure. I do have somewhat of an idea now. I've got 14 cards here. Don't know what to do for my third one, for my 15th one, but I will have to tinker around, find some combination that suits me best, and yeah. So that pretty much is it for this video. I hope it helps, and until the next time, you guys, have a happy new year.